In 1963, if you wanted to do calculations, you had a mechanical calculator, like this wonderful Odner Brunswiga. But it's all mechanical. This guy, 1962-63, Bob Reagan, worked at Friden Incorporated, maker of mechanical calculators, had this idea, let's invent an all-electronic calculator. Indeed, nothing mechanical in it. It's all electronic. And I've been lucky enough to not just get one of them, but to meet and talk with the late Bob Reagan, who came by and helped me repair two of them. Signed by Bob Reagan, August 2006. This is a cathode ray tube out of an oscilloscope, four circuit boards. It's all discrete transistors. Each one of these is one transistor. Each of these probably cost $5 or $10 in 1962. Germanium transistors, resistors, diodes, circuit boards that are not just double-sided, but sort of, in an odd way, four-sided. It folds in on itself, plugs in, and there are four different. But even that's not what I find amazing. In any calculator, you have to keep track. You need a memory. You need to keep track of the numbers. Where's the memory? This used a piece of piano wire for memory. You would tweak one end of the piano wire, vibrate, go around, around, around in a spiral, and at the far end, there'd be a little microphone to hear it. Each pulse was a ding, ding. It was called recirculating audioacoustic memory. It's all in here. The number 5, binary 0101, had to have ding, no ding, ding. So a ding was a bit. It remembers in time. It takes about, a hundredth of a second for these little bits to go around this long spiral. Come on over, Brady, check this out. Now let's look over here. First, you can see there's a spiral out here. Every time there's a bit, like the first bit in the number 5, over here is a little speaker that goes boink, little magnetic coil that goes boink, and launches a pulse, a little doink, goes around here on the spiral of piano wire, steel wire. It spirals in, then spirals out, and a couple milliseconds later, it gets to the far end where there's a tiny microphone, a microphone over here, which goes out into an amplifier and then into the circuit boards. So the memory of this calculator is all acoustic. Every time you type a number into it, the bit stream of the number is represented continuously as vibrations in this wire. The alternative, of course, is what we'd do today. You'd have solid-state memory. Well, solid-state memory, well, there's five, let's say there's six entries in the stack. Each one has, say, 10 digits. It's more than that. It's 13 digits. Well, let's say 10 times 6 is 60 digits times 4 bits per digit. It's on the order of 250, maybe 5. I would need somewhere between 200 and 500 transistors. And each transistor is costing me a dollar. That's big bucks. And on top of that, it takes up space. So rather than using transistors, as we would today for memory, put all the information in acoustic memory. Okay, I'm working on this. My problem is, in August of 2006, I got it working. It was working in November of 2013. Today, I'm sorry, guys, it's sort of not working very well. And I'm going in with an oscilloscope. The oscilloscope is there. Okay, so unfortunately, you can see it's dancing around. If we type a number in, bam. I can see that two of the scanning boards are working. I can also see that I've got some troubles in the arithmetic board and the logic. No, I've got work to do. The happy thing is, alongside this that Bob Reagan helped me fix, I've got a second one, which happily, as of last night, was working. Not sure it's working now, but let me give it a try. If I'm lucky, oh, we'll do all our calculations with 7 decimal places. There is a stack of 4 numbers, and I enter on the lowest stack, which should be brightest. I'll enter 22, enter. Now I have 22. Oh, I'm going to divide by 7. 7, divide. 3.14, an approximation for pi. We just showed that it divided. Let's do a square root. Square root of 2. 2, square root. Watch how long it takes. Boop. It takes a second to do a square root. Let's actually go all the way out, do it to 12 decimal places. 2, square root. It takes the better part of a second to find the square root of 2, but it does it. And in 1963, people were astonished. Hey, when I first used this in college in 1971, 72, I was astonished. Find the square root of 2 to a dozen decimal places in a second. Wow, I don't have to look it up. I don't have to do an expansion. Absolutely sweet. So this machine that I'm working on, I compare voltages to this working machine. So I'm in there. And you can see, hope it's visible, Brady.
That, yeah, it's very visible.
So now let's do the square root of 2. 1.14. Let's crank the decimal place back here. Clear entry. 22. Enter. 7. Divide. And there's an approximation for pi. A little bit of a lousy, few digits of approximation. And so to repair this guy, I'll be comparing voltages from this guy here into here. And check this out, of course. It's a continuing problem. November 2013, repaired, okay. So this guy's working. Why do I work on this? It's partly out of respect for those who came before me. Brilliant engineers. It's partly out of a sense of appreciation for their work, for their use of the available technology that today people will laugh at it. Discrete transistors? I'm not even sure you can buy a discrete germanium transistor anymore, certainly not one made by Texas Instruments. It's admiration for those who came before me. And, of course, it's also a wonderfully entertaining jigsaw puzzle. Debugging software, hey, I don't need much more than a computer and a brain. Debugging hardware, it means understanding not just what's supposed to happen, understanding not just what is happening, but also understanding what was in the mind of the people who created this. The reason for working on this isn't, oh, look, I've got a museum piece. No, that doesn't mean anything. The reason is it teaches me, it gives me a sense of joy that I'm bringing to life what people who came before me gave birth to. Every time I want to add, let's try something slightly more complex. Let's set this to 14,600,531. So this is 14,637,531.